is what we do this morning. We have come to worship the King. There is a King, and he is the King of kings and Lord of lords, and we have come into this place to make it known that he is the King and the King of our hearts. And so, Lord, through the power of the Holy Spirit, will you be with us, and would you guide us through this time of worship this morning and make us come alive to the things that you love and come alive to your amazing truth. May us we come alive, even once again, to your remarkable grace. We pray these things in the name of the one who taught his own when they prayed to say, Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
We confess our sins each week as an act of worship because in doing so, we acknowledge to God and to each other that he is our only hope of forgiveness and redemption. So let's do that together this morning using our corporate confession of sin. Together. Eternal and merciful God, you have loved us with a love beyond our understanding, and you have set us on paths of righteousness for your name's sake. Yet we have strayed from your way. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, though what we have done and what we have left undone. And remember the lavish gift of your grace, manifested perfectly in the sacrifice of your Son. O God, we praise you and give you thanks that you forgive us yet again. Grant us now, we pray, the grace to die daily to sin and to rise daily to new life in Christ, who lives and reigns with you and in whose strong name we pray. Amen. Hear now these words of assurance from the Psalms. The Lord is compassionate and gracious, slow to anger, abounding in love. He will not always accuse, nor will he harbor his anger forever. He does not treat us as our sins deserve, or repay us according to our iniquities. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his love for those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed our transgressions from us. Dear friends, if you are in Christ this morning, by the word of God, we can say together that your sins are forgiven. Well, let's stand now together and sing our hymn of assurance, I Stand Amazed in the Presence. We have confessed our sin, let's now profess our faith in answer to the question, Christian, what do you believe? I believe in God the Father Almighty, the maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Be seated, please. Come now, you who are the beloved of God, let's go to him together in prayer. Heavenly Father, we praise your great and glorious name today. You who are the infinite and eternal King of glory and King of grace. There is no one like you, for you alone are merciful and gracious, slow to anger, abounding in steadfast love and faithfulness. Father, we thank you for the beauty of this new day you've given us and for the evidence of your creative hand everywhere around us. We pray today, Lord, for the many needs in our congregation. And while each one is known to you, we voice them today, acknowledging that you are the hope of your people and our only strength and shield. Lord, among us today are some in need of a healing touch from you. Please grant healing and renewal of strength that we might rise to praise your great and glorious name and give you full credit for our healing. And for those, Father, with long-term health challenges, remind us that even on our bed of suffering, we are never far from your care. Some, Lord, are in need today of encouragement from your word and from the lips of your people. We pray that you would speak peace and hope to us, Father, and remind us that you are at work in our lives, even when we cannot see it or feel it. Remind us today, Lord, of your covenant care for those who are your own. Thank you for calling us from out of darkness to walk in your marvelous light. And remind us today, Lord, that you spared not your own Son, but delivered him up for us all, and will you not, along with him, graciously give us all things? And remind us, Lord, that we have a calling on our lives, a calling to glorify you before a watching and listening world. Help us this week to be agents of grace to those whom you've placed in our lives and others whom we may meet only in passing. Glorify your name in all the earth, O Christ, and be pleased to use us to speak to the gospel to those who are walking in darkness as we once were. And now, Father, as Pastor Rob soon stands before us as your messenger to your people, we pray that you would give him abundant grace and the fullness of your Spirit so that his words would truly be your words to us. And we pray all these things in the name of him who loved us and loosed us from our sins in his own precious blood, even Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen. At this time, would you please stand and find someone new and greet them in the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ. As you're making your way back to your seat, want to warmly welcome you to Coleridge Presbyterian Church. If you're visiting with us, we're so glad that you're here this morning on this Lord's Day. We would love to make this a great experience for you and make you feel at home. We'd also love the opportunity to follow up with you in the next few days and let you know about the exciting things happening here in the life of our church. So if you would take a minute to fill out the Visitor Connect card in the pew rack in front of you. You can drop that off with one of the ushers during the offering or bring that to the narthex following the service. If you took a baby bottle from Hope Women's Center a few weeks ago, they are due back next Sunday. You can bring that either to the narthex or anytime during the week to the Welcome Center Monday through Friday. Also, a number of announcements in your bulletin, the insert. One in particular that I want to point out is the Equip America event. Equip America is a new initiative from Evangelism Explosion International, and they are traveling the country doing one-day workshops, and we'll have the privilege to host a one-day workshop here Saturday, February 29th. In the Kennedy Fellowship Hall, 8:30 a.m. to 4 p.m. If you've never been trained on how to share your faith and would love to know and just get a sneak peek of what it looks like, this is a great opportunity for you to test the waters, to see what it's like, and to experience a one-day workshop where you can see what it's like to be a part maybe of a full semester starting next fall. But this is your opportunity to get engaged maybe for the first time. Maybe you took EE 30 years ago. But just need an opportunity to get re-engaged and brush up on what you learned a few years ago. This is a great opportunity for you as well. We're opening this up to the entire community, so invite friends, other people that want to learn how to share their faith. Please invite them to the Equip America one-day workshop on Saturday, February 29th. Also in the bulletin, you'll notice that there is an insert. We are in the season, just as we did in the fall, in nominating deacons. We are nominating ruling elders for our church. So the elder nomination form is in your bulletin. You will have this in your bulletin for the next several weeks. You can bring that back with you next Sunday, or you can bring that back during the week as we are looking for you, the congregation, to nominate members in good standing, those men that you believe have been called to lead our church and to serve as your shepherds. Would you please take time to fill out that form and prayerfully consider nominating someone to be a ruling elder here at Coleridge. And last but not least, you'll also notice in your bulletin a postcard that says Connect with Coleridge and New Ways to Give. Starting this week, we are introducing a new platform online for giving, event registration, something that is much more user-friendly than the old program that we've been using for the last decade. We heard from many of you of how complicated it is or not really user-friendly. And so if you go on our website to crpc.org, you can see our new online platform for giving, event registration, and other opportunities. We are also launching today our app for either Apple or Android. On the new app, you can download it immediately. You can watch previous sermons. You can give. You can register for new events. You can see our devotionals that we've provided throughout the last few years, all online. So new opportunities to get engaged, to give, to also sign up for events. On the other side, Connect with Coleridge, we hear from many of you. We don't know what's going on at the church. When are the next events happening? And a lot of you aren't signed up. You're not registered for our weekly eConnect. Maybe you'd like to receive a text message notification from you. So all from us. Or maybe you just need to update your mailing address. So we, for the next few weeks, will just be pushing what we're calling a communications campaign. We want to let you know about the exciting things happening here at Coleridge. And there's a number of platforms and ways in which you can stay engaged in the life and the ministry of our church. So please take advantage. If you're not signed up for our email, text message, need to update your information, your mailing address or phone number or email, please take advantage of this as we move into our 60th anniversary year. We have a lot of exciting things happening here at the life of the church, and we want you to be aware of every single thing that is happening. Well, at this time, we have the opportunity in our worship, it is an act of worship, to give back to the ministry of Jesus Christ here at Coleridge Presbyterian Church. I invite at this time our ushers to come forward for our morning tithes and offering. approach your word, may we understand that this is truth from heaven above. This is the word. And Lord, we are told that the word has become flesh and dwells among us. So Lord, more than anything this morning, I pray that as we open up your word, that we would see Jesus high and lifted up. And we would encounter him, the risen Lord, and our lives would never be the same. Amen. You may be seated. This week, as we continue our series, God's Story, Our Story, we are reminded that we made the case and have been trying to make the case every Sunday that all of the stories of the Bible, all of those random facts and figures and names and themes and characters, all of the things that just don't seem like they go together or have a point and purpose, we made the case at the beginning in October that all of the stories point to one ultimate story. That all of the stories beginning in Genesis 1 and wrapping up all the way in Revelation 22 all point to the story of stories, the story of God coming into the world in the person of Jesus Christ. And so we continue our series as we search for that one story each week in the midst of all the stories of the Bible, as we attempt to engage the Word of God in such a way that it builds a biblical worldview, a foundation that guards our heart and our mind, that we begin to think like Jesus and ultimately love and act like Jesus as well, because our worldview is shaped by the very Word of God. We continue our series by looking at Genesis chapter 22, the story of Abraham and Isaac, chapter 22, verse 1 through 14. Next week, we'll be looking at chapters 25 and 27 as we spend the next few weeks looking at the life of Jacob, as we have spent the last 4 weeks looking at the life of Abraham. Now, today, looking at the life of Abraham and Isaac. This, in many ways, is the climax of the story of Abraham, the most famous incident, or you could say, in many ways, at least the first part of this story, the most infamous act or story of Abraham, as Abraham is called to do what seems to be impossible. By chapter 22 that we enter into this morning, Abraham has finally had the promised child. He has finally had the child that would bring hope to the world. He would bring, the child would be born, and the favored promised child of God comes in the person of Isaac. Isaac's name means laughter, because after all, this whole thing has been laughable. A barren woman, pressing 100, is going to give birth to a son that will be the hope of the world. This whole thing has been laughable. All of the things that Abraham has been called to do, and decades pass, and still God does not deliver on his promise. And so finally, the promised child, at age 100 for Abraham and Sarah, is brought into their life. And appropriately, they name the child the son of laughter. We pick up in Genesis chapter 22 the story of Abraham and Isaac, reading verses 1 through 14. After these things, God tested Abraham and said to him, "Abraham," he said, "here am I." And he said, "Take your son, your only son, whom you love, and go to the land of Moriah and offer him there as a burnt offering on one of the mountains which I shall tell you." So Abraham rose early in the morning, saddled his donkey, and took two of his young men with him and his son Isaac, and he cut the wood for the burnt offering and arose and went to the place that God had told him. And on the third day, Abraham lifted his eyes and saw the place from afar. And then Abraham said to his young men, "Stay here with the donkey, and I will be with the boy. We will go over there and worship and come again to you." Abraham took the wood of the burnt offering and laid it on Isaac his son. And he took the fire and the knife, and they both went together. Isaac said to his father Abraham, "My father." "Here I am, my son. Behold the fire and the wood, but where is the lamb for the offering?" Abraham said, "God will provide for himself the lamb for a burnt offering, my son. So they both went together. And when they came to the place that God had told them, Abraham built the altar there and laid the wood in order and bound Isaac his son and laid him on the altar on top of the wood. And then Abraham reached out his hand and took the knife to slaughter his son. But the angel of the Lord called to him from heaven and said, "Abraham, Abraham." He said, "Here am I." He said, "Do not lay your hand on the boy or do anything to him. For now I know that you fear God, seeing that you have not withheld your son, your only son, from me." Abraham lifted up his eyes and looked. And behold, behind him was a ram caught in a thicket by his horns. And Abraham went and took the ram and offered it as a burnt offering instead of his son. And so Abraham called the place, "The Lord will provide." As it is said this day, "On the mount of the Lord it shall be provided." And the grass on this day continues to wither and the flower continues to fade. But the word of our Lord, it stands forever. Amen. Here am I. What a audacious, bold, and courageous statement that Abraham utters from his mouth. Here I am, for the ancients, was not the equivalent of a casual hello. Here I am to the ancients was their way of saying, "I stand ready to serve and to do whatever you are asking me." Knowing what we know about what follows, do you think Abraham probably should have asked, "Well, it depends, God, on what you're asking me to do"? But this is the type of faith that Abraham exhibited. Before he even hears about the greatest test that he will ever face in his life, offering up his son, he says, "Here I am. I stand ready to serve, regardless of what you're about to ask me." And what's even more amazing about this is that Abraham had already gone through so many tests. Abraham had already gone through so many challenges. Abraham had already gone through so many callings in which God had called him to do what seemed to be impossible. God called him to, in Genesis chapter 12, leave his land and go to another land. He called him in Genesis 15 to offer up sacrifice and enter into a covenant with God. We read that last week in Genesis 15. We read 2 weeks ago that God calls Abraham to offer up Ishmael and Hagar and send them on their way. And now God is calling him to do this. And this is what we see here. We see a man ready to do whatever God has called him. This morning, I want us to look at briefly two remarkable things in the calling, and in my opinion, the most daunting calling of God to Abraham. The first thing that we see here is we see the dilemma of love and justice. In verses 1 through 8 in chapter 22, we see the dilemma of love and justice. God calls out to Abraham, and the word comes to Abraham from God. And this is what the calling is, and this is where we see the dilemma. In verse 2, he says, "Take your son, your only son, the one you love." Remember, this was the son they had been waiting for decades. This was the promised, favored son. And the word "son" here in chapter 22 is used 10 times, not by mistake, but in order for the reader to understand the gravity of what God was asking Abraham. Your son, your only son, the son that you love. Other translations of this verse read, "your favored son," or "the only begotten son." Sound familiar? The only begotten son, the favored son of Abraham. Yes, that son, I want you to sacrifice. And sacrifice how? The passage uses the language of a burnt offering. What's a burnt offering? A burnt offering was used by the people of God in the Old Testament to pay the debt of sin. You see, the people of God understood this, that God is holy and they were not. And so they would have to make offering and sacrifice to pay for the debt of sin. And one of the ways they would pay for the debt of sin is they would make burnt offering in their context of worship. And here's where the dilemma is. Abraham is recognizing that God is asking him to sacrifice and to offer him up as a burnt offering because Abraham needs to pay the debt of sin. And it's in that moment he is confronted with this dilemma, and it is the dilemma of love and justice. On the one hand, God is saying, I am so holy and I am so just that you must offer up your son to pay the debt of sin. But on the other hand, ringing in his ears and still in his mind is the promise of God in Genesis 15 that I will do everything, even according to my own blood, to deliver on my promise. And so this command here to offer up burnt offering in light of my holiness seems to contradict the promise of God. And it's in that moment where I'm sure Abraham was confronted with this question: how could there be hope with a holy God? How could there be hope with a God of justice? You see, the God that calls Abraham to offer up burnt offering is a God that is declaring his justice to Abraham and the world, that there must be justice on account of sin. A debt has to be paid. But there's the tension. But it continues to go further. In verses 3 through 6, after being asked to offer up his son and to make a burnt offering on account of sin, in verse 3 through 6, Abraham obediently by faith obeys God. And what does he do? He cuts the wood and he puts it on his son's back. And they make that treacherous climb up the hill in verses 3 through 6. Can you imagine the agony? Can you imagine that horrible trek? But there's the question, the appropriate question from Isaac in verse 7. Father, we have the wood and we have the means to make a fire, but where is the lamb? Where is the lamb that would pay the debt of sin? Where is the lamb that would satisfy your justice? And Abraham tells Isaac, God will provide. And there lies the tension. On the one hand, Abraham is saying, son, God is such a God of justice, we must pay the penalty of sin by burnt offering. But God is also the God of love. And he is the God of promise, and therefore he will provide. And you see the tension and the horrible dilemma. A debt has to be paid on the one hand, but God has promised to not only be the promise maker, but as we learned last week, to be the promise keeper. A debt, yes, has to be paid for our sin, but God will surely provide. It is the dilemma of love and justice, not only for Abraham, but it is the dilemma of love and justice that all of us face in life. The reality that there is a debt that needs to be paid, but a God who has promised to deliver hope, a God who has promised to provide. And as Abraham and Isaac are walking up that hill, and Isaac is carrying the wood that would seemingly, it seems, lead to his own demise. Imagine this boy, the commentators tell us, have to be 10, 15 years of age, a boy old enough to carry the wood up that mountain that would eventually be used to sacrifice his life. You can imagine the internal agony of a father. God is just. But he's promised. He has promised me by his blood that he will be the God that delivers hope, that he will be the God that delivers upon his promise of redemption. But the story doesn't end there. And oh, thank God, the story doesn't end there. The story does not end us with us hanging in this area of wondering how would God ever, on the one hand, satisfy his justice, and the other hand, satisfy his promise to deliver and provide. You see, the second thing that we see in Genesis chapter 22 is not only the tension of love and justice, but in the midst of this story, we see the very provision of the Lord. In verses 9 through 14, we see God provide. In verse 9 through 10, finally, as Isaac is bound, can you imagine the agony of Abraham binding his son to that wood to be sacrificed? And as the knife of death is in Abraham's hand, ready to come down on his son, imagine this. The messenger of the Lord cries out and says, "Stop, stop, for you have proven to me this day that you fear God." In other words, you have proven to me that you do not fear man and that you do not doubt the promises of God. That in the face of adversity, in the face of what seemed impossible, you believed in the God of promise. Your faith never wavered. Stop. Stop. And what happens next? In verse 13, Abraham looks up, and in verse 13, what is there? A ram with its horns caught in the thickets. And Abraham takes off his son from that sacrifice and from that wood of the burnt offering, and instead places the ram upon the wood. And it's in that moment that a ram takes the place of Isaac, that God would provide a substitute for Isaac, so that in the ram, in the burnt offering, both God's justice and his love would be satisfied, that his command to pay the debt of sin would be satisfied, but his promise to deliver and make good on his promise of hope and redemption would all be satisfied through the sacrifice of a ram that day. But remember, it's only a ram. You see, when Abraham was climbing up the mountain, he specifically said, "The Lord will provide not a ram, but a what? A lamb." You see, on that day, God provided a ram for Isaac, but left the door open for a lamb to eventually come. You see, what Abraham saw that day is the lamb that would come, a lamb without blemish, that one day, centuries later, a man by the name of John the Baptist would come and he would say, "Look, behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world." Do you notice in that passage that Abraham names that mountain not "the Lord has provided," but the future tense, "the Lord will provide"? That Abraham, by faith, looked to the day, John tells us in John chapter 8. He saw the day of Jesus, and it made his heart glad. By faith, Abraham looked forward to the perfect Lamb of God who would come to take away the sins of the world. And it was the Lamb of God that he looked forward to by faith that is the only thing that gave him the power to climb that mountain. And it's the only thing that would give you the power to climb that mountain as well. A lamb that would come to pay the debt, but to also deliver on the promises of God. Behold, the Lamb of God. On top of Mount Moriah, the very Mount Moriah that we are told in 2 Chronicles contains a hill called Calvary. And it would be centuries later, on the mountain range of Mount Moriah, on a hill called Calvary, that the only begotten Son of God would climb, and God the Father would place the wood of his demise on his back and force his Son to climb Calvary, Mount Moriah, and on that hill, as the Son of God cried out on that wood, on that offering to pay the debt of our sin, as the cry of the Son went out, the Father answered in silence. And that, for you and me, is the greatest news we could ever receive, because it was the silence of God the Father which offers for you and me this morning the only hope of how God could both satisfy his justice but deliver on his promise to never leave us nor forsake us. You see, it was not Abraham's obedience that saved him, but his audacious faith in a God who will always deliver on his promise. You see, I don't understand what Abraham saw exactly. I don't understand all the particulars, but I'll tell you this. The book of Hebrews, centuries later, in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 19, says this: He, Abraham, considered that God was able to even raise him, Isaac, from the dead, from which, figuratively speaking, he did receive him back. I'll tell you this, that on Mount Moriah, Abraham, not understanding all the particulars, understood this one thing, that he believes and trusts in a God of resurrection, and that he believed full well that I don't know how it's going to happen, but I'm coming back with my son alive. I'm coming back down this mountain with a son that is not dead, but alive. Can you imagine if you and I actually lived with this kind of faith? Not a technical faith where we come to church and assent and believe all these things to be true, but functionally, every day, actually climbed your Mount Moriah with this type of faith, that we were able to say, there's death on that mountain, but I'm coming back with life. That there is despair on top of this mountain, but I'm coming down with hope. That there is utter loss on that mountain, but I'm coming back with the provision of God. In Isaac, Abraham thought he had all of the significance and all of the security this world offers. But he looked to the Lamb. He looked to the Lamb that offered him complete security and complete significance, more than he could ever hope for or imagine. It's a story of a country church that contained mostly farmers, and a drought swept over their community. They went weeks upon weeks with no rain, and so the pastor, understanding the dilemma and the what their congregation was going through, called a Sunday evening prayer meeting to pray for rain. And so Sunday evening came, and hundreds gathered in this little country church. And as the pastor walked from the back to the front, he saw people gathering, socializing, laughing, fellowshipping with one another. And as the prayer meeting started, he looked out, and what did he see? A little girl in the crowd with a big umbrella opened wide. That church came that day to pray, but that little girl came expecting the rain. And my greatest fear for us as a church is that we would come Sunday and maybe Wednesday, and we would sing, and as long as our attention span would hold, listen to the sermon, and it wouldn't mean a thing. It wouldn't change a thing in our lives, because I fear that we just come to church. And I want to know this morning, is God stirring within anyone that says, I don't just come to church, I'm expecting the rain. I'm expecting God to do the impossible. I'm expecting God, the God that raised his son from the dead, to do the supernatural in my life. I believe in a God that raised his son from the dead to pay a debt that I could never pay and carry a burden that I could never carry. Where else can you find a man like this? Behold the Lamb of God. You have a debt that you could never pay and a burden that is impossible to carry. By faith, would you look to the Lamb? Romans chapter 10 tells us very simply, for those that confess with their mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe it in their heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. And this could be the day where the Lord is stirring in your heart, maybe for the first time, to be awakened for the very first time to this God who delivers on his promise, the God who can do the impossible. Would you look to that Jesus in hope and in faith and in salvation? There are some in this congregation that have been walking with Jesus for 30 years, but you have lost the remarkable, exciting, amazing nature of God's amazing grace in your life. And might God be stirring in your heart again a renewed passion that I'm not only going to come to church, I'm going to expect God to do the impossible. I'm going to believe in the one that has paid my debt. I'm going to believe in the one that is faithful on my behalf, faithful to do the impossible, faithful to deliver on his promise, and look to the Lamb. Oh, Coleridge, may we not be a people who just come to church, but may we be a people who expect the rain. Let's pray. Our Father and our God, oh Lord, this has the temptation and the risk of being such a familiar story. Kind of like the story of Noah, we grow up hearing it. We might have heard it before, vaguely familiar with some of the details, and it does nothing to us. But Lord, you're present with us. And Lord, I want to ask right now that I know there are people here that just come and they sing and they sit and they leave and the word of God does nothing. But may they encounter Jesus this morning, and may we bank on your promise that your word will not return void. And if there is anyone here this morning that is failing to believe, and maybe hear something like this and it sounds too good to be true, that you are the God that came down in Jesus Christ and carried our burden and paid our debt, may what seems too good to be true be revealed to us by the power of your Holy Spirit to be true. And if anyone is sitting here this morning and has never entered into a relationship with God through Jesus Christ, simply say this: God, this morning I acknowledge that I'm a sinner. I acknowledge that my sin is so great that I could never pay it. I could never satisfy it. Would you forgive me and carry my burdens? Would you come into my life and make me new? I no longer want to live as if there is no God. I no longer want to attempt to pay for my debt and carry my burdens. But I look to you by faith, and I transfer my trust to everything I've been banking on in this life to give me hope and meaning and significance and security and even forgiveness, and transfer that trust to the only one, Jesus Christ, who in the cross, by way of the cross, satisfies both our debt and delivers on his promise once and for all. Oh Lord, I came in here living for this world, but now I leave here as a child of God. Great is your faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. Let's stand and sing. If God has laid anything on your heart this week, or maybe even for the short time we had together this morning, there will be elders in the narthex that would love the opportunity to connect with you and maybe even say a word of prayer for you as you go. Now receive this good word, and may it sustain you today and this week. May the Lord bless you, and may he keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. And may the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace, now and forevermore. Amen.
Say